heart of West Yorkshire sport.
BBC Radio Leeds.
And here comes Gordon Strachan, David Batty and Gary McAllister, the impish Scott Strachan, carrying a wreath in memory of his great friend, Gary Speed. Oh, so tragic that the fourth one is missing.
On the 27th of November 2011, the world of football lost a great player and figure. A family lost a husband, a father, a son and a brother. To many, he was a friend and an inspiration.
This little lad came in, black hair, smile, and I just couldn't believe what I was seeing. He was an exceptional boy even then.
Always looked $1 million.
The sort of bloke you would have been pleased to see your daughter bring home.
Always wanted to know what you'd been up to rather than talk about himself.
He was successful in everything that he did.
Just a gentleman, a true football man, a great friend.
You know, get down as one of the great players that Leeds United have ever had.
I will always do my best for the team. And that was Gary Speed.
BBC Radio Leeds pays tribute to a true gentleman of the game as we reflect on a distinguished career by recounting some of the great stories told by his teammates, managers and friends. I'm Adam Pope with Speedo. Gary Speed, remember.
Away goes Speed. He's got a start on them all this time. Go on, Gary Speed, get one yourself, son. And what a great goal. And Gary Speed's really wrapped things up.
From my point of view, I could have won a bit more. I've been a bit more successful in that respect, but I've got no regrets and I've had a great career and I've got a great life.
It was clear from an early age that Gary Speed's destiny was to be extraordinary. His place of birth, Mancot, a small Flintshire village in North Wales, translates as humble dwelling. How apt, then, that Gary was the epitome of humility, modesty and respect throughout his life. These qualities were nurtured by his parents, Carol and Roger, along with his sister Leslie, and they held him in great stead. They set him apart from others, as identified by the Welsh FA's Education Welfare Officer, Cledwyn Ashford.
I've known Gary since he was 8 years old. He went to Queen's Ferry Primary School. And the deputy head teacher at Queen's Ferry was a man called Ron Bishop, who gave his whole life to developing boys football, and Gary happened to be in his school, and Ron Bishop came in one day and said, look, I've got a lad 8 years old. I said, Ron, we're running an under-11s here. Oh, he said, he's special. And this little lad came in, black hair, smile, immaculately looking type of boy, you know, he looked smart and he was intelligent, and he came out for a training session and I just couldn't believe what I was seeing. He was an exceptional boy even then. And of course, history will tell you, he played for 3 years for Deeside Primary Schools. He held the record for a number of goals. Ian Rush, of course, was one of our greatest players. And Ian Rush is still known now, isn't he, as one of the greatest goal scorers of all time. So Gary had to live up to his reputation, which he did. And then he made the most appearances as well for Deeside. And that was only broken years later by the now well-known Michael Owen. But Gary was, yes, he was a smashing player. Played in midfield, had a great left foot, could head a ball even at 8 and 9, could rise up above boys twice his height. And there are things that you remember about him. He was an old head on young shoulders, because whenever we went away to play in Gloucester, Vale of Whitehorse, Jersey Festival, it would be tradition for the captain to get up and thank the hosts for their hospitality. And he was doing that at 9 and 10. He was articulate, he was intelligent, he took on the responsibility, never affected him. There was nothing at all big-headed in him. Went on then to play for me later on for North Wales under 14s. Went for Welsh trials at under 15s and in fact didn't get in. I went absolutely mad because, you know, I couldn't understand why they couldn't see the potential in this boy. He wasn't the biggest, but he was better than half the people there, but he didn't get in. But of course he made up for it later on. And then when he became manager of Wales, what a great achievement for him. He then started working with our under-16 boys. We became even closer again. And he used to come down every time we had a camp, Gary would be there. He'd be giving his time, he'd do coaching sessions with them, he'd get involved, you know, playing games with them. And he was just, for me, a very, very special person.
Speed into the near post!
That journey began at Elland Road as a teenage apprentice. Gary's father, Roger, helped him make the decision to join Leeds United rather than any of a host of other clubs who wanted to sign him. It's fair to say the life of a budding young footballer in the 1980s was to be far removed from that of the modern-day Premier League starlets, as Gary explained.
We went to trials for Everton, Liverpool, Man City, West Brom, Sheffield United, Chester, Wrexham, all, and I went to Leeds, and Leeds signed me on, and when Eddie Gray was the manager, then he got sacked and Billy Bremner became manager, and, you know, I was just leaving school and I didn't know whether I was getting taken on or not, so, you know, I played a good game at the right time, Billy Bremner said, yeah, we'll have him, and that was the first bit of luck that I had, I suppose, and then you go into your 2 years apprenticeship type thing, and you got 20 lads there of all similar abilities and trying to get one or two places, and from those 20 lads, there's only myself and David Batty and Simon Grayson, who played for Leicester and Villa, and that came through that. So in that respect, it's luck, and in other respect, it's maybe a bit hard work and dedication.
The young Speed was in good company, though, as he was joined on day one at Elland Road by future Leeds player and manager Simon Grayson. It appears much of their early days were spent staying on side with the senior players, but they did make time for the odd laugh or two.
We both signed schoolboy forms on the same morning at Elland Road when we were 14 years old. In them days, that's the earliest you could sign any sort of affiliation with a football club. We were in a room together, my parents and Gary's parents, and that was the first time we met. And I suppose a lad coming out of Beedale, sort of an hour from Leeds, had never heard a Welsh accent or a North Wales accent in his life before. And he was a real nice lad to meet straight away, and obviously from then on, we spent 2 years as schoolboys and then apprentices and professionals together. So, well, yeah, it goes back to when we were 14. We sort of cleaned the dressing rooms together, plenty of banter going around as you do in them days when you're apprentices. I think people look back on Gary and think he was quiet as well, but he was quite a mischievous apprentice as well, that there's plenty of banter going around. I remember having something happened with Peter Maguire, who was from Huddersfield, and he ended up tied up on Fullerton Park in them days, and he was naked, strapped to a goalpost, cold water thrown all over him, and he didn't find it very, very funny at the time. A few weeks later, Peter Maguire again did something wrong, and he more or less ran back to Huddersfield before Speedo and others could get hold of him, and that sort of, that was part of being an apprentice. You learned quickly and you had to grow up quickly in them days. Speedo was behind a lot of them pranks that went off when we were apprentices.
Avoiding the ritual dressing room humiliation of football's version of Tom Brown's school days was, I suppose, the luck of the draw. Fortunately for Gary, he met Peter Swan, a fearless character who played both centre-forward and centre-back for Leeds and whose hard-as-nails reputation on the pitch was betrayed by his kindness off it.
You can look back and say, yeah, it's nice to be around people like that, because you met him when he had nothing to start with. And I met him a couple of years back, and what he is now, he was still the same person, which is great to see. When we come to Leeds together, he was a year younger than me, and then eventually became my apprentice, which was one of probably an hard thing for him to master, when we used to go out together, do things together, train together, get changed next to each other. And then from one day, from the Friday, and I came in on Monday, I was a professional, I used to look at him, and he looked at me and thought, please don't ask me to make me tea, please don't ask me to get your towel. First couple of days I did, which you do, don't you, because you like to throw your authority about. And I could see the pain on his face at times, and it's not nice to see when a kid that you've been training with. I thought, nah, we're in it together. And from then on, Friday afternoons, he used to go sit in the boot room, polishing my right boot, he was doing my left, and we used to sit and do things together. So I never really took advantage of the situation. I should have done, really, because I've been too soft in my life with him.
How were the other pros with you about that? Were they going, go on, Swanee, give him a hard time?
Yeah. They all wanted to give the young pros an hard time, well, the apprentices an hard time. But I was too soft. As much as you think people class you as an hard man, inside me I'm soft as. And for people like to have him around, who was a lovely kid, diamond of a lad, he used to keep asking the same questions. Swanee, when's it going to be my turn? When am I going to get the chance? Because like people like myself, Nigel Thompson, Lyndon Simmons, Dave Batty, always getting the nod before him. And he was like worried that he was never going to get the opportunity. And when he did get it, if he took it by both hands and ended up with more appealing to the Premier League than anybody. So it was one of them that he used to comfort you. And you don't realise until after how important I was in his life, to be honest. Because I wrote a book and he did a part in my book. And he said when he first come to the club, people like myself would look after him. And I thought, well, how did I look after him? But he must have just been in how I comfort him with things I used to say at times, like, i.e. being the professional and not taking advantage of him. So there's certain scenarios which I didn't know I was doing.
Just an arm-around type of character rather than someone that needed a kick up the backside, was he?
Yeah, you don't kick him up the backside. He's too nice and too cute and pretty, wasn't he? I don't think many people did. And to be honest, not many people had to, because he was 100% say, professional from the start to finish. When everything he did, he wanted to be the best at it. When he went out, he wanted to dress the best. And that's just how he's been from start to finish. So that's how it was. Nobody really took advantage of him because they could see that he was in training. He wanted to get in that first team. He wasn't scared about the step up into the reserves. And when his first team came, like I say, he took it with both hands and went on to win many trophies.
You're listening to Speedo. Gary Speed remembered on BBC Radio
Gary
Leeds.
Speed, right footed. He's done it again.
There was no doubt he was an exceptional athlete, blessed with endearing abilities. Howard Wilkinson, who managed Speed in the iconic Leeds side to last win the title in 1992, gives a typically considered and analytical assessment of the young player's abilities.
My first memory of Gary was playing on a Saturday morning before a Leeds home game, one of my first Leeds home games, and he was playing for the youth team. And if my memory serves me right, on that occasion he was playing at left back, and the youth team coach at that point was a guy called Peter Gumby. And I remember distinctly that morning, Peter, when I sort of asked him amongst this group, who do you think's going to have a chance? And he said, well, the young boy playing at left back, I think's got a real chance, he said, but don't think it's at left back. And I think within a couple of years of that day, I'd given his debut. I think I gave him his debut towards the end of the following season, actually. So, probably less than 2 years. He had a great attitude. He was very genuine, very honest. Whilst you wouldn't have picked him out as, at that point, the most skillful player, possibly in the group, in terms of technique, he did have attributes. Good left foot. He was a good athlete. And even at that point, was good in the air. What you look for in boys at that age, in particular, is the capacity to improve. And because of his attitude, as I got to know him, I knew that that he would improve. He would, if you like, make it his deliberate aim to get better. I remember part of the process, we discussed him, obviously, and part of the process was that he was one of those people who was probably going to need a bit of time and a bit of managing in terms of getting him to feel as easy in the side as he could possibly be, and you want him to be. And that was the case, and I remember the moment I thought, well, he's now come of age, and that was in an away game at Southampton when he scored, I think it was our first or second goal. He hit one from about 25 yards.
Speed tries a long one. Oh, what a way to round the match off. Two for Strachan. And what a second goal for Gary Speed. 4-0 for Leeds.
From the moment he'd sized up the ball as it came to him on the pass, you could see what he was thinking in his head. His execution was terrific. And that's the point where I thought, well, I think now he's what you would call our first team player. And you'd put him down then as one of your first team pool of players.
Too much, too young is the often heard criticism of those who realise success early on in life, particularly of those who fail to capitalise or maintain the desire to try and repeat the feats which appear to have come too readily. Speed could have fallen into that bracket, but when the opportunity presents itself to write yourself into its annals, history cares little for age. At 22 and with a medal to his name, he and his Leeds teammates savoured the moment of becoming champions of England, especially at the expense of their bitterest rivals. Defender John Newsome recalls some poignant moments with Speed in an unforgettable season.
One of the great memories that I do have was making one of my first appearances. I came on a sub at Tottenham, and Mel Stirling had gone off with an ankle injury, and we got a corner on the right-hand side, and lad said, you know, up, go on, Newsome, up you go. So I went up, and Speedo was stood at the edge of the box, and I said to him, where does Mel go on corners? And he said, go on a penalty spot, Newsome, you know, you're going to score here. And I don't know whether he meant it or just a bit of tongue-in-cheek, I would imagine, knowing Gaz. But the ball came over, I got the flight of it, managed to beat the keeper, stuck it in the back of the net.
Newsome! Would you believe it? He's just come on as a substitute. He's only appeared once before as a substitute this season. And that's his first goal for Leeds United.
I had no idea what to do in terms of celebration. And looking back on the photos and the footage, I was totally embarrassed all week because I got this face of like a bewilderment, really. And Speedo was jumping on my head, laughing and screaming. I couldn't believe that I'd actually scored. And then probably the biggest memory that I've got is the day that we won the league at Bramall Lane. There's a number of photographs of the day, you know, I scored at the back stick with a header. And there's him and Chrissy Fairclough stood round me. And I always remember after scoring the Tottenham goal, I thought to myself, next time you score a goal, smile, you know. And I scored and I turned round and Speedo and Chrissy Fairclough were there. And I remember just thinking, smile. And time went on, we won the game. And after the match, Gary came back to my parents and me and him went back to my mum and dad's house in Sheffield to watch the game, to watch the Liverpool Man U game. Obviously, you know, history was made that, you know, Liverpool beat them and we'd won the title and we were sat in my mum and dad's front room, I think with a pot of tea or whatever, you know, laughing at 21 and 22 years of age with what we now knew we'd got a championship winner's medal in his pocket, like, you know. And it was about the time when mobile phones were just coming to the fore, so a few of the lads had got them and we all contacted each other and we'd arranged to meet at the Flying Pizza in Leeds at 7 o'clock, I think it was. So we jumped in my little Astra and flew up the M1, got back to Leeds because we lived in apartments which were very close to each other, got changed and off we went and I'd, you know, gave the ball a kick that night and, you know, it was, yeah, special memories, really, very special.
A decade after that title win, Gary reflected on the achievement in a BBC interview.
I always remember going to the final games of that season because Man United hadn't won the league for so many years and it was us and Man United. And people thought we pipped them at the end, but it wasn't like that. I think we were top in October till about December and then they went top till about February and then we were top for a few weeks. And then Man United were top for the last 3 or 4 weeks. And, you know, I always remember Howard Wilkinson said, you know, he said, you've achieved more than anybody could imagine you have achieved. So just don't think about anything else, but just go out and enjoy the last 4 or 5 games. You've got nothing to lose, just go for it, you know. And that took all the pressure off us, and we just went out and enjoyed it, where the pressure was on Man United so much that you could see, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You could see the pressure was on them, you know. We were watching game West Ham away when Kenny Brown scored that goal, you know. Yeah. You know, we could see the pressure on them. And the last but one game of the season, we played Sheffield United away, and we beat them 3-2.
Speed now against Gale, and Wallace, it's in! Well, would you believe it? That's an absolutely astonishing goal.
You get the feeling the next goal is going to be vital. There's McAllister's free kick.
Newsome! Oh, it's 2-1. John Newsome, who used to play across the city at Hillsborough. He doesn't look like he can believe it. Cantona's racing on. Dale in there. He's kneaded up. He's headed it over. It's gone in. It's 3-2. The most remarkable goal, and it could just decide the championship.
That was in the 12 o'clock kickoff, and then 3 o'clock, Liverpool were playing Man United. You know, we beat Sheffield United. Yeah. That means Man United had to win, which obviously wouldn't happen now because we were in an advantage. So when we went down and watched the Liverpool-Man United game, you see the Liverpool team were really up for it because they didn't want Man United to win the league. Dean Saunders was playing for Liverpool, and he said he's coming to the game on the bus. And he said all the Scousers were coming out of the pubs going, come on, you know, because Leeds beat Sheffield United because they didn't want Man United to win the league. And there was only going to be one result, and then that was it. We won the league on a week before the end of the season.
You're listening to BBC Radio Leeds. I'm Adam Pope with Speedo. Gary Speed remembered. Leeds fans of a certain vintage will reel off the early 90s midfield of Strachan, Batty, McAllister and Speed, just as those of more senior years venerate the first-choice Revie 11 of the 70s, in what can only be described as a Gregorian chant. It was a quartet which effectively combined ability with dedication to task. The side before self philosophy espoused by the club's finest player Billy Bremner, the manager who kept Speed on at Elland Road as an apprentice, was manifest in Wilkinson's engine room, in which Speed was a crucial cog.
He was terrific in their box, he was terrific for us in our box, and between those two areas he was great at doing the job well. Because of his qualities, I had the option of playing him wide or bringing him in. So consequently, people found it difficult to tie us down. They thought they knew what we played, and most of the time they'd say, oh, Leeds play 4-4-2. The fact is, we very, very rarely played 4-4-2. He was an equal part in a four-part, very strong midfield. They were a perfect four.
I've read a lot over the years about his friendship with David Batty. Do you remember much of the two of them being together?
They were the odd couple, I suppose, in some senses, opposites attract. And maybe Bats was being clever because he knew with his looks he were never going to do very well in the female stakes, so he tagged along with Gary, and he knew that there'd always be options if Gary was around. Yeah, they were different people, but deep down there were two youngsters who enjoyed doing what young adolescents enjoy doing. Once they got to the football club, they were different in the sense that Gary had one way of doing things, David had another. It worked for both of them, although it worked better for Gary in the long run, because I remember saying to David on many an occasion that, you know, footballers would increasingly expect to be playing when they were 37, 38, 39, but you're only going to get that length of career out of the job if you put it into the job in the week on the training field. And that's what Gary did. I mean, the older he got, the more he got into that world. And had he not gone into coaching, he would have still been playing at 40.
How integral was he to helping that Leeds side win the title?
He played an equal part, particularly once he got a season under his belt. Gordon gets the plaudits for not only his ability as a player, but his ability as a captain. Gary gets the plaudits for his passing and his touch, and then people remember him vis-a-vis Liverpool. David Batty, you know, he was all over the place. Gary was your... If you looked at Gary, you got a bit of everything. If you had to just settle on one rule in a football club, the rule would be that each player would swear that I will always do my best for the team. And that was Gary Speed. So I think by the time he left, either by selection before the game or by moving him in the game, he'd played every position except goalkeeper. And never once complained. But with Gary, so long as he understood why, and so long as he recognised it was because it was better for the team at that point, no problems, he would get on with it.
Following season, went into Europe, and my favourite Gary Speed goal, I mean, look back at lots of them, was the one against Stuttgart. Do you remember that particular goal, or were there any other ones from the European campaigns that stood out?
No, I just got used to him appearing when you couldn't see a possibility of a goal, and he would appear. Basically, because he arrived in the box late, he was brave, so whether it was on the deck or in the air, lots of his finishes were one-touch, and so therefore you were a bit surprised. You know, it wasn't, oh, here comes the pass, and yeah, Gary Speed, and yes, it's going to be a goal. It was, there's a cross gone in, and then where's he come from? You know, when he'd make up 15, 20, 25 yards.
Batty tacking down the right, but he looks for Cantona, and it's a good ball to Speed. What a magnificent goal!
Well, it's a referee to goal. Gary Speed has forced the ball in. It's been lost, here, Speed. It's in, he's got it through the crowd of defenders on the Spurs line.
I can see him in my mind's eye stretching out and toe-poking him in. I can see him being up and getting across people, powerful headers. I can see him getting at the near post. I can see him side-footing him in. And then occasionally, as with the Southampton goal and a couple of others, where he's cut inside, had a few touches and then popped it in the bottom corner. He took ownership, and that's what you want. He took ownership, and you can ask no more than that, because what they're saying is, I will take responsibility for my performance.
When you look back then, how do you think you'll remember him best?
I remember him best as a very, very, very good footballer, as being a genuine, honest, nice bloke, and the sort of bloke you would have been pleased to see your daughter bring home.
Gary Speed developed into a marvellous character because of the loving and devoted support of his family. His father, Roger, remembers him with immense pride.
We still don't believe it. We're still wondering why, and he had the world at his feet. So, it's been a struggle. It's been a hell of a 12 months. It's overwhelming, the tributes we've had. I mean, all corners of the globe. Australia, Africa, New Zealand, America, Canada. People we don't know. It's tough.
Was it a help?
Oh, to see what people thought of him. Everybody thinks the son, best person in the world. But when it's the other way around, the world think he's the best person. That's where it comes from. What people thought of him. We didn't realise, until it has happened, it was worldwide. We thought, oh, everybody knows him in Leeds and Newcastle and Liverpool and, but not the world. Oh. And the tributes he got from top players in the world, Platini and Sepp Blatter and all that, all of it in Europe. It's overwhelming.
What legacy did Gary leave, do you think?
Inspirational, I would think. Anybody follows him, it's inspirational. You know what I mean? What he done. I mean, it wasn't just football, it was anything. Game in the house. Gary would always win. Everybody wanted to be on his side when we were playing games. Christmas, you play game. Everybody wanted to be with Gary because he knew everything. He seemed to know everything anyway. I kept saying to him, where do you think you are? Question of sport. Because he was always good on there. So that's very inspirational, because all I can say, I must state, I am an Englishman. I'm a Chester. I was born in Chester, within the city of Wales. I'm a converted Welshman. And I want Wales to do... I want Wales to beat England now. Honestly, that's what Gary's done to me. The national anthem airs on the back of my neck. So, he converted me. He'd be the only Welshman in the family, Gary. Just because he was born here. Just down the road there.
Because he wasn't a shouter or a bowler, was he?
Oh, no. Only when he was playing he'd shout. He'd have a shout and a moan. And the Costa Rica game, Howard Webb come over to me and he said, he is the best professional that I have ever reffed. He said he made a mistake in one game or something, and Gary said, come. He said Gary came up to him, patted him on the shoulder, he said, don't worry about that. He said he'd make a lot more than that. He said, just carry on as you're doing. And Howard Webb, he thanked me for that.
He did so much, didn't he, in sport. He did so much in football.
I think he achieved everything he wanted to achieve, I think. Except winning a big competition, the World Cup, like a lot of people. But he said his final achievement was honour, manager of Wales, his country.
Put into words how proud you are of everything, even a life taken away like that.
He's given me a great life. He's given me and Carol a great life for the people we've met and what the people do for you, honestly. I mean, you were talking before about coming to Newcastle. John Carver phoned me. What a goal for the Swansea game. But Joe Raw takes me through Everton, go to Leeds, Gary McAllister, Gordon Strachan. Brilliant people. But it's nice to go that people still remember him now when you go to the football matches. I mean, Leeds United still sing his name now. Tremendous, tremendous tribute.
Listening to Speedo. Gary Speed remembered on BBC Radio Leeds.
What Gary gave to Leeds United is a league championship, which is, the top of all football players' wishes to win the league championship in your country. Great commitment to the football club, and he'll go down as one of the great players that Leeds United have ever had.
Eddie Gray, who devoted an illustrious career to Leeds United. But most players, managers, directors and chairmen revolve through the office and dressing room doors of several clubs in their lifetimes. The click of the turnstiles, however, is the preserve of those who commit themselves to a team for life. And so, the worthiest measure of any player is the esteem in which he is held by the fans who pay to watch him. Gary Edwards has missed only one Leeds game since 1968. This is his assessment of Gary Speed's time at Elland Road.
He's up there with the best. I'm one of these old school, and my favourite team was, you know, Rini, Cooper, Bremner, Charlton, Lorimer, Clark, Jones, Giles, Gray, and Nigel Martin in goals. But as far as number 11 is concerned, he's not very far from Eddie Gray at all. He's certainly in the top 13, 14 Leeds players I've seen. He was such an all-round star. His heading ability, shooting ability, tackling, he could do everything. Really. Absolute supreme player.
He just seemed a guy that fans could take to straight away. I mean, obviously, you've named the abilities that he had as well, but was he more than that as well?
It were a fantastic. Everything with us. He attended every Kippux, our Kippux branch, every single day. In fact, he came without invites. He would come in anyway. Him and Batty, who were great mates, David Batty. And he came to everyone, and he were always time for you. I remember seeing him in a nightclub in Cork. It was a Monday night, raining. We'd gone over there for a friendly, and there were about a dozen of us in, and McAllister got us into this nightclub, and we sat with Speed, and you couldn't see the table for whiskies. It was just great. Nobody were falling about drunk. It was just his hospitality. Smashing bloke. Really, really genuine fella. I remember seeing him and Batty trying to get into a nightclub in Tokyo, and it was about 4:30, 5:00, and this bouncer were having none of it, you know. And they were both dressed in Hawaiian shirts and Hawaiian shorts, you know, and both there just saying, do you know where we are? You know, and this bloke were not having none of it. And then we ended up in this Hard Rock Cafe, which was 24 hours, and they came in there then, you know, later on, him and Batty. But they were great fun, great. You know, you can't talk to players these days like you could then, you know. There was just something about him. He's obviously, ladies loved him, you know, and blokes did and all. You know, he was just one of these players. Everything about him was too good to be true, really.
Do you have a particular memory, Gary, of Gary Speed?
Quite a lot, actually. He scored at Everton when we first came back from the second division back in 1991. And he scored that day, and we took Everton back by surprise that day. And I remember.
Three up at half time, wasn't
it? That's right, yeah.
Riley trying to make something of it. Southall came eventually. Riley barged into him. Play on set. A referee to go. Gary Speed has forced the ball in. And Leeds.
His heading ability. He were up there with some of the best headers I've ever seen. And he's, like I say, just skillful. For a winger to head a ball like he did, he seemed to hang there, seemed to wait for the ball. And his timing. And he were powerful. And he could tackle for a winger. He could tackle. Oh, no, you can't praise him enough. He was just a brilliant player. And to say the number 11, there's only him and Eddie Gray can sort of like, you know, compete in that, because the two of the finest wingers I've ever seen anywhere. And you can't be any more complimentary.
It's impossible to find an example of Gary being content to rest on his laurels. His appetite for self-development appeared insatiable. A sporting life complemented by dashing looks has been the ruin of footballers for time immemorial. Not so Gary Speed, whose self-doubt and empathy for others meant he never displayed the arrogance of many fallen idols. His ability to avoid making salacious headlines was a testament to his professionalism. But don't be hoodwinked into believing he was a goody-two-shoes all the time. Speed was best man to Wilkinson's first signing at Elland Road. Neil Parsley.
Like to obviously remember everyone that he was Welsh. I mean, how you can say that with a little bit of a Scouse twang that he had, I don't know. But, no, he just had an operation on his... on a varicose vein that he had on his leg. And we'd obviously had a vast amount of alcohol, and Gary decided to give all the local lads a rendition of Green Green Grass in Beebe's, where it used to be down Greek Street. And then... we went to Mr. Craig's, where Gary decided to fall down the steps after too many bottles of Beck's, and was clutching out for people to pick him up off the floor, where everyone was laughing at him and left him alone there with a body stocking on and various stitches in his leg. Like in the digs at that particular time, there was Top Gun the movie, and me and him used to sit there watching Top Gun, and, you know, we used to know it off by heart, and... He won't thank me for saying, like, but he loved Dirty Dancing as well. We used to watch the Dirty Dancing with Patrick Swayze and Water Fight. Very, very down to earth. Gary loved a kip. Oh, he was frightening, even from a young age. He loved a kip. And he used to sleep in a ball on his knees. And, you know, it'd be quite comical, because I used to room with Gary, and we used to wake up and he'd be in this ball in the fetus position, but on his knees and his elbows, with his head on the pillow. You know, it was quite funny to wake up and see that, how somebody can be comfortable.
Speed was an established Wales international by the time he left Leeds United.
Comes the corner from Blackmore, in dangerously. Speed is up there, and Gary Speed has scored the goal, which brings Wales back into the match. Gary Speed, the sweeper, rose superbly to meet the corner. Powerful header inside the far post, beyond the defender on the line, as well as beyond the goalkeeper.
The manner of defeat to Aston Villa in the 1996 League Cup final was the catalyst for the move to Everton, where manager Joe Royle revealed that he was one of the most straightforward signings and one which paid dividends in his time at the club. Speed was priceless.
I knew that whilst we had good players, I needed that extra ingredient in midfield. A midfielder who could score goals, who could win the ball, who could do the lot, and Gary fitted the bill. I'd always been a big fan. I'd seen him many, many years previously when he was on a family holiday in the Seychelles. I'd never forgotten him. Loved the way he played football, loved the spirit of the guy, and of course fantastic in the air. Timing and jumping early, and he almost hung in the air and scored a hat-trick for us. I think it's the only hat-trick of his career at Goodison Park, and looked set to rule at Goodison Park for years, even after I'd gone.
Hinchcliffe kills it in, Woods lost it, and Speed is there. His first ever hat-trick in senior football.
He had a great reputation. Everybody knew about Gary. Everybody knew that the player and the person were top-notch, were 10 out of 10. And when I met him, I wasn't disappointed. In fact, he was even better. And the signing was one of the easiest I've ever had to do. His agent came in first with a message. I may as well tell you now, Joe, I've been told to get this done. It's going to happen no matter what, so let's be fair. And it was done very, very quickly. There was no great negotiation, and he was an Evertonian who wanted to come back to Everton. Gary again made an adult decision, a mature decision, if you like, that he'd done all this with Leeds, there'd been changes at Leeds, and he felt it was time for a change from him. He wasn't unhappy with Leeds. He had great affection for Leeds and always will, and I remember talking with Howard Wilkinson at Gary's funeral about it, and he really loved Leeds, but he always had that soft spot for Everton. He'd been an Evertonian as a kid. He was a Corinthian, if you like, a modern day. He played the game right. Yes, he got bookings, but it was never for anything malicious. There was never any great dissent. He was a man of few words in many ways. He didn't have an awful lot to say. If he was with the boys, I know that he would sit there laughing and giggling rather than being the leader of the pack kind of thing, but they all loved him and respected him for that.
And a leader of men, though, on the park.
A natural leader. Yeah. A natural leader, not a bawler and shouter by any means. He knew what he wanted and he knew what was right, and he wouldn't be scared of speaking his piece, but he wasn't going to go out there and bang his fists and grab all the people around their neck and snarl at people. He was just Gary Speed. He just did the right things at the right time. Just a lovely guy, you know, and we knew what he was going to give us, and he gave it. He never disappointed, never complained, trained like a professional every day to the ultimum, and played to the maximum every week. He was absolutely faultless.
Speed's departure from Everton was shrouded in controversy. He told the Liverpool Echo, "I can't explain myself publicly because it would damage the good name of Everton Football Club, and I'm not prepared to do that." Some Blues fans berated him when he returned to face Everton, who may have coined £5.5 million, but in real terms, it was their loss and very much Newcastle United's gain. It was no surprise to John Carver, who coached Speed at Newcastle under Sir Bobby Robson, that the Geordie nation embraced him.
"The one thing about our fans is, if you give 100%, and you do wear your heart on your sleeve, they will adopt you." And they adopted Gary, because when he first came in, he was having a tough time. But because of his honesty and endeavour, he stayed with it. And eventually the quality that he had came through, shone through. And that's what these fans appreciate. You know, they knew that Gary would run through a brick wall. And he did an awful lot of things in the community and for charity and things that people don't realise how much work he actually did. and that's why they talked of him. And I know for a fact he loved living in the northeast. He never wanted to leave. I was actually not involved with the conversation, but I was in earshot of the conversation when Sir Bobby asked Freddie to give Gary a new contract, and Freddie almost said, "Well, no, Nicky Butt's coming in." But Bobby was adamant he wanted Gary Speed because he knew the type of... He was his blue chip boy. He wanted to keep him here. At the time, we were actually pushing on two fronts. We had the Premier League, but we were also qualified for Champions League football or European football. So we had to be careful, and Gary wasn't a spring chicken. And the way he played, he covered every inch of the pitch. So we had to make sure we looked after him. And it was quite funny on some days because we played on a Saturday. He would have Sunday off. And on a Monday, he would come in, and I knew he'd had a few beers with the lads on a Sunday in the local pub, but he would come in on a Monday and say, and he would just look at me, and I was waiting for the words coming out of his mouth, and these words would be, "JC, you're getting nothing out of me today." And I would just say, "Not a problem, Gary," and I would just turn a blind eye to the way Gary was training, because I knew by the time we got to that game on the Wednesday or the Thursday, he'd be ready to go and ready to play. So, you know, sometimes you have to turn a blind eye to that. He was such a winner. He wanted to win everything he did, whether it was a five-a-side, whether it was press-ups. He wanted to do the most press-ups. He wanted to do the most pull-ups. He wanted to lift the heaviest weight. And if he didn't, he got annoyed. And we knew once you stepped over the line in a game, he was a winner. And he was one of our blue... What Sir Bob used to call him, one of the blue-chip boys, because he knew we could rely on him. And he was the first name, along with Alan Shearer, on that team sheet, because you knew what you were going to get out of him. And he was a winner.
You're listening to BBC Radio Leeds. I'm Adam Pope with Speedo. Solana. Gary Speed remembered.
That's Speed's goal! A lovely ball in from Solano, just at the right height, inviting for the Welshman Speed.
Speed's eventual departure to Bolton Wanderers was a blow to Sir Bobby and Newcastle. At the Reebok, Gary became the Premier League's inaugural 500 appearance maker, and in 2007, the first to score in each of the 16 seasons since its inception. Howard Wilkinson had spotted that Speed, as a title winner in 92, had the qualities to extend his time in football beyond the playing surface. His thirst for knowledge meant he often discussed training plans and routines with coaches, and after a brief stint helping out at Bolton, following the departure of Sam Allardyce, Speed had a taste for a more managerial role. How strangely the wheel of fortune spins, as the two young lads who turned up at Elland Road together both became managers. Simon Grayson again.
As soon as we both got to the back end of our careers, we ended up doing our coaching badges together, and we went right the way through from the B licence to the pro licence, which is a long time to do. But again, Gary was always one that was asking questions, always sort of wanting to learn from the courses we're on, but also on a night time he was always the one that probably liking a drink and being happy to be around, and had a distinctive laugh that people will talk about, that you knew that Speedo, if he was in the next room, you heard this laugh that you knew it was him, because that's what he was all about. He was a happy-go-lucky lad and just a fantastic person to be around.
Speed seized the opportunity to test himself in the precarious world of football management only after ending his playing career in the Championship with Sheffield United, where his captain was Chris Morgan.
Sort of no disrespect to ourselves, but, you know, we've got Speedo coming in who'd, you know, never played outside the Premier League. You know, so I think as a group of players, you're always, you know, unsure of players coming in. What we got was, you know, an absolute gentleman. And the minute he walked into this football club, he just, you know, I think he gets the respect straight away. He was very forward thinking. He wanted the team to play, but he wanted the team to play in the right manner. You know, he wanted us to compete. What he didn't want us to become was a team that just played football and, you know, got brushed aside easy. You know, he wanted us to be hard to beat. He wanted us to be tough. But he wanted us to be tough both on and off the ball. First game away at Middlesbrough, you know, we were drawing 0-0. 0-0 would have been a great result for us. I ended up sort of going for an header, dropping a clanger. I got underneath it and misjudged it. And Chris Boyd ran off the back of me and scored. And I remember sort of, you know, you think I've let people down today, and especially with it being Speedo's first game. And anyway, I rang him and I just said, "Gaffer," I says, "well, by the way, it's Morgs." I said, "I just wanted to apologise today." I said, "You know, a point away from home of Middlesbrough would have been a fantastic point." And I says, "I just feel as though I've let you down." And he just said down the phone, obviously I can't swear, but you can imagine he just went,
Morgs, he said, I can deal with that. He said, I can deal with people making honest mistakes. He had, you know, big expectations of people and of himself. But I think he also realised that, you know, when people were giving their all for him, I think he, again, that's how he sort of looked at himself as a player. I remember apologising and basically he'd give me a stripping down for apologising, really. But nights out and things like that, you know, he always one for a laugh, always, you know, when the time were right, you know, when we'd trained hard and worked hard, you know, when the time came for the lads to, you know, get the dancing gear on, he was always the first one dressed in reception, always looked $1 million. Gaz Naismith always used to say he'd look smart in a bin bag, and he would have done, you know, whatever he had on, he always looked $1 million. You could go on all day. I mean, he's just a gentleman, a true football man, a great friend. You know, I'm probably in a privileged position where, you know, I was, you know, lucky enough to be able to call him a friend and a close friend. He's sorely missed, you know, and I think every time you see a picture and you look at that smiling face, and like I said, I can still hear the giggle now. Every time I see a picture of him, I can hear Speed, that little laugh of his. Just a true football man, and you know, just I think anybody that was ever in his company, nobody will ever have a bad word to say about him.
It takes a special individual to successfully metamorphosise from player to coach to manager, and amongst the same group, whilst keeping their respect and your own integrity. John Carver, who was brought to Bramall Lane as part of Gary's backroom squad, witnessed the moment it occurred.
At Sheffield, at the training ground, we had a sort of a great meeting room where we used to do all our team meetings. And it was really interesting because I've always done the team meetings, but when I got to Sheffield, Gary did the team meeting. And it was how we were going to play against the opposition. I'm trying to think, I think the first game was Middlesbrough, my first game. And when he stood up in front of the group, because it's not easy doing it, he stood up in front of the group and he talked about how we were going to play and what to expect from Middlesbrough. I just thought, he's gone from a boy to a man. And I've never said this to anybody before, but that was my thought, because I'd been doing it a long time. I'd been standing up in front of teams, as I do now, talking about how the opposition are going to play. He did it, and it was the first time I seen him do it. And as soon as he did it, I just went, he's going to the top.
If there was an air of inevitability that the proud Welshman would soon be managing his country, there was certainly none about the sensational effect he would have in turning the nation's fortunes around. A 50% win ratio and voted FIFA's best movers of 2011 had Planet Football believing Wales could qualify for their first major final since 1958. The chief executive of the Wales Football Association, Jonathan Ford, was intrinsic to the appointment of Speed.
He's a very proud Welshman and ultimately saw that as being the ultimate honour in his career and an ultimate opportunity to craft his trade. He saw his role not just being as the manager of the team, he saw his role as being the manager of football in Wales. And boy, he really did go about that with all his heart and with all his gusto. Everything was reviewed and Gary very much did it in the way that he thought was the best way of doing it, and it was what we call the Welsh way. We've often been criticised at times for the guys not singing the national anthem, and one of the things that we did do is get on top of the players. And actually, I remember there was a session up at the training camp where we brought the anthem singer along. We got the guys to understand the meaning of the words and the history of the anthem, and we all got up and we all got them to sing the national anthem. And of course, driving that Welsh spirit, that Welsh passion, that loyalty is an incredibly important part of the job. You know, at the end of the day, these guys, you know, play for their clubs. They're paid extremely well. Of course, on international duty, it's not the case. They're doing it for the love, they're doing it for the badge, they're doing it for the flag. And of course, that's very, very important, that a manager can galvanise his team in such an incredible way. And the best person I've ever seen do that was Gary Speed.
Do you have any particular memories or stories from his time in charge that stick out for you?
To give you an idea of the man, I mean, you know, he really was a person that lit up a room, any room that he walked into. You know, of course, his office was just opposite mine. We're very much an open plan office, and Gary very much was a part of the team. Occasionally we used to do this sort of payday pub club, you know, where, you know, we get paid once a month, of course, and, you know, to celebrate, a few of you go down the pub. Gary used to join, you know, the staff and go down to the pub with them. There was a birthday club, and, you know, everybody put in £3. I don't think I'm doing it myself, but I mean, I think Gary did. You know, and he put his £3 in, and every time it was somebody's birthday, they sang happy birthday to them and gave them a little bit of cash. You know, when we played staff team matches, Gary became part of the staff team and played football with us as well.
Did everyone want him on his team?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, he just was that kind of person, you know. But it wasn't at all, you know, people looked up to him, but he was very much one of the people.
How do you think the Welsh fans will remember Gary Speed as both a player and a manager?
Oh, very affectionately. You know, I don't think anybody has ever said a bad word about Gary Speed, and I don't think anybody ever will. Just a generally nice guy. I mean, I suppose that the thing that you miss most is the gaping gap that's left.
Gary Speed was a winner, but not at all costs. He was talented, but never conceited. He was engaging, friendly and supportive to everyone. As Kipling wrote, he was a real man, who could walk with kings nor lose the common touch. He was that and more. A family man, who loved the company of others, like his teammates, and especially the class of 92, with whom he created an everlasting memory for Leeds fans and players alike. And thankfully, something for himself too.
After the year we won the league, we went to, just went to Spain, a lot of us, and I was talking about the team spirit, and we were just on a beach in Spain after we won the league, and, you know, a few drinks and, you know, a few songs and all day dancing about, and it was just a fantastic day, you know, with all the lads there, and the team spirit was fantastic. And, you know, somewhere about 7 o'clock at night, you know, the sun was going down and the mood changed and somebody put this song on, and we all just sat there and just be quiet. And I always remember the feeling just sitting on the beach there listening to this song, and no one spoke, and it was a memory that I'll always have in my mind. And as soon as the song finished, Chris Fairclough went, right, let's go and get changed and go out. So it was just one of them moments where you'll always remember, and this song, whenever it's played, I'll always remember for that reason. Is it getting better?
Or do you feel the same? I will always do my best for the team, and that was Gary Speed.
If you shut your eyes, anybody can think of him arriving at Ender Across in an Everton shirt, a Leeds shirt, Newcastle, Sheffield United, wherever he played.
He never disappointed. Played to the maximum every week. He was absolutely faultless.
He's certainly in the top 13, 14 Leeds players I've seen. He was such an all-round star.
He spent more time on the training pitch, he spent more time in the gym, he spent more time thinking about what he was supposed to eat. When he had to work, he worked, and he was so dedicated.
Gary would pick up if you were down. He'd show concern over others, other well-being, rather than talk about himself and ask, how are you doing? Everything all right? You act like you never had them.
Was a proud Welshman. You know, he was a bright boy. He could have made it at any game he wanted because he was just a sportsman. But more than a sportsman, he was a true gentleman.
We still don't believe it. We're still wondering why he had the world at his feet. It's been a struggle. It's been a hell of a 12 months. He's given me a great, I'm Callum, a great life.
This is going to take the free kick for Leeds. Goes into the box. Heads up from Gary Speed! Gary Speed lances the ball! Into the far corner of the net!
He was a Corinthian, if you like, a modern day. He played the game right.
Inoki Down is one of the great players that Leeds United have ever had.
He was a winner. So Bob used to call him one of the blue chip boys because he knew he could rely on him.
I don't think anybody has ever said a bad word about Gary Speed, and I don't think anybody ever will. The thing that you miss most is the gaping gap that's left. I think it's just a hole that will never be filled.
Life doesn't need any explaining, does it? You know, he was successful in everything that he did.
Every time I see him with his family. I see him with his wife and his two boys and his mum and dad because we're so close, and he was such a positive person.
When the time came for the lads to get the dancing gear on, he was always the first one dressed in reception. Always looked $1 million.
had a great attitude. He was very genuine, very honest.
Had a distinctive laugh that people will talk about, that you knew that Speedo, if he was in the next room, just a fantastic person to be around.
A great fella, on the pitch, off the pitch. He lived his life like, you know, he played his football. He always gave it everything he'd got. Just a gentleman, a true football man, a great friend.
He lived more in his life than a lot of us will get to live if we manage to live twice his age.
I still expect him to walk in through a door. He's one of those people that doesn't go away. I still see him, you know, in my mind. He'll always be there.
That was Speedo, Gary Speed remembered on BBC Radio Leeds.